Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. We are really lucky, alhamdulillah, that our Dr. Zakir Karim Sahib is here in Madras. But since the question and answer session is there, I would like to just put forth before him the questions have been asked to me by non-Muslims very often, but I am still not able to answer to them in a correct perspective manner. Dr. Sahib, it is our firm belief that the believers will go to Jannah and the non-believers will go to hell. But a Hindu or a Christian often asks me that we are born in a Hindu family or we are born in a Christian family and naturally we will continue to have to follow the same religion. It is not our fault whether we will also go to hell forever or shall we also go to heaven. And second question, I used to tell them, you are supposed to read the Holy Quran and understand the religion. But another firm belief is, even a Muslim, we should not supposed to touch the Quran without wazu. We have to be wazu and then only we must read Quran. But how can a non-believer who is not a Muslim, when Muslims, we ourselves cannot touch the Quran, how can a non-believer can touch the Quran and read? That is a question I am not able to answer. Could you please answer this? Thank you.
The learned brother has asked two questions. The first one is that the non-Muslims say that according to Islam, only the believers, only the Muslims will go to Jannah. How are we to blame that as a Hindu and a Christian, if he's born in a Hindu family, a Christian family, we should blame God Almighty? Well, God Almighty put us in a Christian family and a Hindu family. So how, according to Islam, isn't your Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala unjust that because we are born in a non-Muslim family, you'll be put to hell? The answer that you can give is that according to our beloved Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, every child is born in Deenul Fitr. Deenul Fitr means the innate religion. Every child is born as a Muslim, irrespective whether he's born in a Hindu family, a Muslim family, a Christian family, a Parsi family or a Buddhist family. Every child is born as a Muslim. What is the meaning of the word Muslim? Muslim means one who submits his will to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Later on, by the influence of his elders, the influence of his parents, influence of his teachers, our beloved Prophet said, he starts doing idol worship, he starts worshipping fire, and he goes away from Sirat al-Mustaqim and goes on the wrong track. Therefore, when a non-Muslim accepts Islam, we prefer using the word revert than the English word convert. Convert means going from one track to the other track. Revert means every human being initially is a Muslim. By the influence of other people, he goes on the wrong track. And later on, he is reverted back to the correct Sirat al-Mustaqim, that is Islam. So therefore, revert is a more appropriate word for a non-Muslim who becomes a Muslim than the English word convert. So every child is born in Deenul Fitr. If you ask, what proof do you have today? There was a research done on two tribes, the Kapauku tribe and the tribe of Australian Aborigines. These two tribes did not come in contact with modern civilization till as late as 1950. When the researchers went and tried to find out the way of life, they were following Islam in everything except in name. They believed there was one God, they believed he was almighty, he was omnipresent, he was omnipotent, he did not beget, nor was he begotten. They did the sujood when they prayed to this God Almighty. They were following Islam, everything but in name. They didn't call themselves Muslims. But indeed, they were Muslim. So if you do an experiment today, that if you take a child from a Hindu family, one from a Christian family, one from a Buddhist family, the moment the child is born, isolate him from the other human beings. Let him come up absolutely without in contact with any other human being. Isolate him and let him grow up. See to it he gets food but does not come in contact with any other human being. After he grows up, if you try and learn his philosophy, it will be everything of Islam but in name. Because this is the innate religion Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has put in every human being. The fear of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and the religion of Islam. And Quran says in Surah Araf, chapter number 7, verse number 172 and 173, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, before the human beings came in this world, he bought the children of Adam from the loins. And he asked all the human beings before they came in this world, they were asked, the souls were asked, that do you believe there is one God? And all of them testified, yes, we believe there is only one Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Later on, their memory was washed and they have come into this world. It is their duty to find the truth. But even if they don't find the truth, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala takes it upon himself to deliver the message of Islam. It's the duty of Muslims to dawah. But in spite of that, Allah says in Surah Fusilat, chapter number 41, verse number 53, he says, Sanurihim ayatina fil afaqi wa fi anfusihim hatta yatabayyana lahum annahu al-haq. That soon we shall show them our signs in the furthest regions of the horizons and into their soul until it is clear to them that this is the truth. Allah takes it up upon himself that in every individual soul, besides showing his signs in the horizon, the sun, the moon, the trees, etc., he will even make it clear into their soul that this is the truth. But later on, after accepting the truth, many people, they agree with it, but they don't accept it, because if they accept it, if they become Muslims, they may go lost in business. They may lose their friends. So for material gain, they do not accept the truth. They agree with it, but they don't accept it. And Allah says very clearly that by the age of 40, every human being will agree that there is one Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, at least once in the lifetime. So the message of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is given to every human being, and every human being is born as a Muslim. Later on, he goes to the wrong track regarding that will Muslims go to Jannah. Only by saying La ilaha illallah Muhammad Rasulullah, you do not get a ticket to heaven. There are many Muslims who feel that only by saying the Shahada, you go to Jannah. The criteria for going to Jannah is mentioned, as I said in my talk, in Surah Al-Asr, chapter number 103, verse number 1 to 3, which says, Wal asr, innal insana lafi khusr, illa alladhina amanu, wa amilu salihati, wa tawasaw bil haqqi, wa tawasaw bil sabr. That by the token of time, man is very in a state of loss, except those who have faith, those who have righteous deed, those who exhort people to patience and perseverance, those who exhort people to truth, that is to dawah and islah. These are the minimum four criteria for a person to go to Jannah. If any one of these four criteria is missing, according to Surah Al-Asr, you shall not enter Jannah. You may be a good Muslim, you may have Iman, you may be offering the Salah, you may have gone for Hajj, but if you don't do Dawah, if you don't deliver the message, you shall not enter Jannah. All four criteria are required for a person to enter Jannah. Not only saying the Shahada. The person should have belief, should have righteous deed, that it should be honest, etc. Should invite people to truth, to Dawah, and invite people to patience and perseverance. Only being born in a Muslim family will not transport you to Jannah. Hope this answers the first question. Regarding the second question, that Muslims are supposed to do wudu and touch the Quran, how will the non-Muslim read the Quran? And normally, I'll be dealing with this topic in detail tomorrow, inshallah, in the morning. Al-Quran, should it be read with understanding? I'll be dealing with the subject in detail. But just to answer briefly, what the Muslims refer to the verse in the Holy Quran from Surah Waqia, chapter number 56, verse number 77 to 80, which says that Quran is most honorable, a book well guarded, which none shall touch except those who are pure, except those who are clean. Here when the Holy Quran says, none shall touch it, it does not mean physical touching. Any non-Muslim, they can easily take a Holy Quran and touch it, and the Quran will be proved wrong. They can purchase a copy of the Holy Quran for 100 rupees or 200 rupees, and they can touch it, the Quran will be proved wrong. When the Quran says, none will be able to touch it, touch here does not mean physical touch. It means no one will be able to understand the Quran, will be able to derive the benefit of the Quran, will be able to assimilate the Quran, except those who are clean. Cleanliness does not mean body cleanliness. It means cleanliness besides of the body, it also means cleanliness of the heart, of the soul and of the mind. Touching the Quran without wudu also, you can't touch the Quran. It's not a fard, wudu should be there. You should not be najis in ceremonial impurity. Cleanliness here means you should not be in ceremonial impurities. That's for the Muslim who believe in the Quran. Otherwise, even without wudu, you can touch the Quran. It's preferable to be in wudu. It's not a farz. But you cannot be in ceremonial impurity. You may pose the question, that these non-Muslims, these kafirs, these mushriks, they are najis. How can they touch the Quran? See, the Holy Quran is not meant only for the Muslims. It was meant for the whole of humankind. It's mentioned in Surah Ibrahim, chapter number 14, verse number 52. In Surah Al-Baqarah, chapter number 2, verse number 185. And Surah Al-Zumur, chapter 33, verse number 41. That the Quran was revealed for the whole of humankind. It was not only revealed for the Muslims or the Arabs, but for the whole of humankind. And a prophet, as I mentioned, was sent for the whole of humankind, not only for the Muslims. And if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala holds me responsible for giving the copy of the Holy Quran to the non-Muslims, I will be in good company. Because even a beloved prophet, he dictated letters in which verses of the Quran were mentioned. He gave to the non-Muslim kings. And one such letter is preserved in Turkey in the Koptaki Museum, which says, and it quotes one of the ayats of the Holy Quran, which says, Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, Kul ya ahlal kitab, O people of the book, Ta'ala wila kalmitin sawa'in, bainana bainakum, that come to common terms as between us and you. Which is the first term, Allah na'budu illallah, that we worship none but Allah, wala nushrika bihi, that we associate to partners with Him. Shayyan wala yattakhidha ba'dhuna ba'dhan arbaban min dunillah, that we erect not among ourselves lords and patrons other than Allah. Fain tawallaw, if then they turn back, faqulu shadu, say we bear witness, bi anna muslimoon, that we are Muslims bowing our will to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This verse of the Holy Quran was dictated by a beloved prophet and sent to non-Muslim kings. Some accepted Islam while the others tore that letter and trampled it beneath their feet. So if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala holds me responsible, I will be in the company of a beloved prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him. When he can give the Holy Quran to the non-Muslims, why can't I give? People say, no, we should give only the translation, not the Arabic portion. I am asking, there are 14 million Arabs who are Coptic Christians. The Arabs, Arabic is their mother tongue, but they are Christians from birth. Means they were born in a Christian family. By birth they were Muslim, but they were born in a Christian family. Which translation of the Quran will you give to these Christian Arabs? You have to give the original Quran. So very well, you can give the Holy Quran to the non-Muslims. Even if they make a mistake of touching the Quran, it's a minor mistake. What we have to prevent them from doing is the biggest mistake of shirk. The Holy Quran says, Ta'ala wila kalmitin sawa'in, bainana bainakum, come to common terms as between us and you. Which is the first term? Allah na'budu illallah, that we worship none but Allah. Wala nushrika bihi, that we associate no partners with Him. We are preventing the non-Muslim from doing the biggest sin of shirk. These small sins don't carry any weight in front of shirk. So this is the teaching of the Holy Quran and the teaching of a beloved prophet. You can and you should give the Holy Quran to the non-Muslim so that they will have no excuse on the day of judgment saying that we did not get the message of Islam. If you have a non-Muslim neighbor and he's a mushrik, if you do not deliver the message to him and on the day of judgment, Allah will question him that why didn't you accept Islam? He said, I didn't get the message. Allah says it was your job to get the message, I gave it to you. You go to hell. Allah will pose you the question, why didn't you deliver the message to your non-Muslim friend? Did you deliver the message? And if you say, I have not delivered the message, even you will follow him. Even you will go to Jahannam. I hope that answers the question. Yes, brother, most welcome. First, we'll entertain the question from the mic. And inshallah, if time permits, we'll entertain the question from the slips. If there's any question on sister's side, I believe they can write it on a slip and send it forward.
How to impress upon the non-believer of the Holy Book, the Holy Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, who are themselves are not reading the Holy Scripture, they don't know what is Gita, they don't know what is Puranas, they accept the praise of the Lord Krishna by stealing a butter or fluting the bugle or anything. How we have to be a mubaligh like you to impress upon a non-believer to accept the Holy Quran believes into the entire system of the universe, the faith of the people, and by ending it with Khatmul Mursaleen. If I am not wrong in my question. Do you understand?
The question posed by the brother was that the Hindus, they don't themselves read the Gita. They don't know much about their own holy scriptures. They only know about Krishna, etc. So how do we do dawah with them? What we have to tell them, that you have to ask them, as the Quran says, Ta'ala wila kalmitin sawa'in, bainana bainakum, that come to common terms as between us and you, which is the first term, Allah na'budu illallah, that we worship none but Allah. Wala nushrika bihi, that we associate to partner with him. The Holy Quran says, the best way of doing da'wah is to say, Allah na'budu illallah. If they quote about Krishna, you have to say, dear brother, my Hindu friend, where do you come to know about Krishna? So he will say, in Mahabharata, in Bhagavad Gita. Let him do the job. Bhagavad Gita is one of the holy scripture of the Hindus. So you have to say, since you believe in Bhagavad Gita and you quote Krishna, Bhagavad Gita also says in chapter number 7, verse number 19 to 23, it says, all those who do idol worship, they are materialistic people. Those who do idol worship, they are materialistic people. They say, when they speak about Krishna and other lords, they say, we come to know about these things from the Vedas. So I gave a talk quoting from the Vedas, that if you say you believe in Lord Krishna because it's mentioned in Mahabharata, in Gita, you believe in certain Lord Ram because you believe in Ramayana, because you believe in the Vedas, etc. So if you believe in parts of Vedas, you have to believe as a whole. Your Vedas even prophesy the advent of a beloved prophet. And I gave quotation from Atharva Ved, from Rig Ved, from Sam Ved about the prophecy of beloved prophet. You can even speak to them, Allah na'budu illallah, that we worship none but Allah. Wala nushrika bihi, that we associate no partner with him. You have to tell them, it's mentioned in your Ved, in the Rig Ved, chapter number 32, verse number 3. It says, na tasya pratima asti, of that God no image can be made. It's a Sanskrit quotation. In the same Yajur Ved, chapter number 40, verse number 8.